During any emergency operation, life safety is always the first priority. One of the areas in which our personnel and equipment face danger on a daily basis is while operating on roadways where vehicular traffic is present. That's why the public safety agencies in the Reno-Sparks area of Washoe County have adopted the governor's statewide open road policy. And it's why we participate in the FHWA and Nevada TIM training that has been provided to nearly 50% of Nevada's incident responders, including fire, law enforcement, the Department of Transportation, towing, EMT, paramedics, freeway service patrol, and all others involved in clearing traffic incidents.
Incident responder agencies are working together, enhancing region-wide public safety and fire response procedures on our roadways to support safe, quick clearance at the scene of a crash. It's our goal to promote the safe practices detailed in training and regional incident management plans so that we can minimize risk for our personnel working on roadways.
This video is designed to highlight and complement the new TIM laws and training, but the responsibility for training, safety, and familiarity with these activities belongs to each agency and each first responder.
As an emergency responder, you must recognize the high level of risk you're exposed to while working at the scene or roadway incident or any location where vehicular traffic is present.
You also need to understand that even though there is no absolute protection for emergency responders, you can operate within a protected environment by following these three guiding principles. Number one, provide traffic control. Number two, leave space. And number three, be seen. Now let's take a closer look at each one of these.
Temporary traffic control, or TTC, is accomplished by using cones or flares.
These devices are used to alert drivers to the incident and guide them around or past the incident scene, while still providing safety for those working the scene. Giving the motorists a well-defined path helps to protect everyone working at the incident.
By using traffic control devices properly, we can create a protective space between incident responders and moving traffic.
This is accomplished by making sure the traffic incident management area is long enough and wide enough to provide a buffer and yet still allow for movement of traffic. Being seen by other drivers as they pass the incident is critical to your safety. All personnel working on the scene should wear a high visibility safety vest. Be safe, be seen. Traffic control, leaving space, and being seen are the three main traffic safety principle guidelines, but there are other safety precautions you will need to keep in mind as well.
Always look before you open the door, look before you get out of your vehicle. And when possible, exit from the shadow side of your vehicle. Never assume that approaching traffic sees you. Never ever turn your back on traffic. Of course, you should always wear your personal protective equipment called PPE for your job and be very cautious when you retrieve or replace equipment on the upstream side of the vehicle.
Finally, you want to limit your exposure and time at the scene. You've got to have enough personnel and equipment at the scene to get the job done, but try to keep it to a necessary minimum. Consider leaving the scene or releasing the other units as soon as possible. Remember, the longer you're on the scene, the greater the risk.
First emergency response vehicle to arrive at scene should give an on-scene report to the dispatcher, providing information such as the nature of injuries, entrapment, fire, spills, roadway hazards, or the need for other resources.
And always keep in mind the incident priorities. First, life safety. Second, incident stabilization. And third, property conservation.
Scenes involving fire, rescue, or hazardous material will be controlled by the fire department.
Law enforcement will control scenes that involve crashes or incidents that have no injuries.
And the Nevada DOT will assume control of the clearance of the scene.
The bigger question is who is in charge of what? For incidents that will take longer to clear, unified command should be established as soon as possible to meet the needs of each agency and to ensure the safety of all responders.
We've addressed the three general traffic safety principles. We've talked about specific safety precautions, and we've reviewed the necessary actions of the first arriving unit.
Now let's talk about vehicle placement and blocking. Good vehicle placement will help to secure the scene for life safety and incident stabilization. The first arriving unit should be positioned to protect the scene using a blocking action. Blocking provides an area of protection called the shadow area, and it's downstream of the flow of traffic. Larger vehicles, like fire engines, provide the best block and should be used as soon as possible. A vehicle can be used to block to the right or block to the left. It all depends on which direction will provide the most protection for personnel working at the scene. In either case, the front wheels of the vehicle should be turned away from the work area, so that if the blocked vehicle is struck from behind, it will be pushed away from the work area and not towards the responders.
Here are a few other key points to remember about blocking vehicles. Block the most critical or highest volume lane first, and if possible, block the lane that is already obstructed by the incident. Consider the upstream side of the blocking vehicle as a no-stand zone. Never turn your back on traffic. And finally, when you're using your vehicle to block, exit quickly when it's safe to do so and move to the shadow area. The TIM Coalition can provide safe, quick clearance placards for all emergency responder vehicles that provide sample parking for scenes whenever possible. When used properly, traffic cones and flares create a tapering effect that directs traffic to open lanes and diverts traffic away from the incident. The end of the taper should be at least 100 feet from the first blocked vehicle, with the cones or flares being spaced apart at a distance equal to the speed limit in feet. If the speed limit is 55, the cones or flares should be no more than 55 feet apart. A couple of things to keep in mind when using these devices. Flares and fuel spills don't mix, so always check for spills before laying out flares. And remember, the area defined by the cones or flares is not a safe haven or shadow area. They are, after all, just visual indicators for the motorist. And if you're standing in that area, you are still in harm's way. Another essential tool in dealing with a roadway incident is lighting. The lights can be a distraction or even a hazard for oncoming traffic. So when possible, as soon as the scene is secured, turn off forward-facing or emergency lights and headlights and use only as many emergency lights as necessary to give adequate warning to motorists.
As is the case with any emergency scene, a safety officer may be assigned at the discretion of the incident commander. Safety officer's duties may include ensuring PPE and the reflective vests are being worn, coordinating the use of emergency warning lights, limiting personnel's time spent in high-hazard areas, and coordinating traffic control and blocking vehicles with other agencies. It's important that all emergency response personnel remember there is no absolute protection at the scene of a roadway incident. By applying the general traffic safety principles provided in this video and the emergency response procedures outlined in the TIM Coalition guidelines and the statewide open road policy, as well as the joint operations policy statement, it will go a long way for making the scene safe for us and the public.